Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Amit Lamkar. I am here with my colleague Vijit Morris, and today we are going to talk about how we are using operational data at Intuit to provide meaningful and actionable insights. This is the overview of talk we are going to cover today. We will start with the problem statement, how we are solving it using operational data lake, talk about the applications that run on our operational data lake, get into a demo, and then talk about what we are doing next. First, who we are. Me and Vijit both work for a modern SaaS team within Intuit. It's a platform team. Intuit, as you folks might know, has been around since 1983. We have 5,000 plus developers in 21 locations and serve more than 50 million customers. Here is Kubernetes at Intuit. We have around 1,200 services currently running in prod on 200 plus clusters on 10K plus nodes. We have do a lot of open source contribution, including Argo, which is a CNCF incubation project, and Kiko and Admiral. So objective of this initiative was how we can derive real-time actionable insights on the operational data we have. So when we started with this, there were a few problems we encountered. We were generating a lot of operational data, but they were in silos. There was no standard way to correlate this data and provide insight. Each team used to use their own dashboards to figure out insights in their own silo. And there was no easy way to provide a scalable ML platform. And why it became critical right now, as more and more of our services move to Kubernetes, it increased the complexity due to the dynamic cloud native platform. As well as we are deploying much more that increased the risk. At the same time, Intuit did a DevOps transformation, which required specialized data-driven tooling. So how do we solve this? We created a platform called Operational Data Lake. Operational data lake is nothing but a warehouse of a clean, documented, and schematized operational data, which we collect and process in real time. We collect this data at different life cycle of an application that includes development, build, test, production, security, etc. And then provide real-time analytics using ML on this. Another principle we wanted to follow is we democratize this operational data. So it's available through self-service for anybody at Intuit to use it. So our platform is divided into four parts. One is collection, second is processing, third is real-time ML and analytics, and the fourth is storage and retrieval. Let's get a little bit more details into each of these. In collections, we use Kafka for our real-time ingestion. We also support batch using Cribble for things like structured log. And yes, data governance is inbuilt and moderated by Data Steward. For processing, we do real-time processing using Apache Kane. We have cataloging using Apache's Atlas. We want to make sure everything is cataloged and discoverable for folks who want to use this data. We also provide enrichment using Golden NTT. We use asset ID in our case. On analytics side, we created a standardized ML platform that highlights the anomalous behavior in any stream of data that enables us to provide a guided debugging option. As far as visualization is concerned, we created a standardized pattern for both visualization and triaging. We also offer an interactive exploration using Druid. And all this data is stored in a long-term store, S3 and ELK for batch frame. Let's go over a high level of ODL architecture. On left-hand side, you can see we have set up of producers. It includes our Kubernetes platform. It includes build platform, API gateway. We get security data, hotel data. All this data is collected in real time through Kafka. We ensure that everything is cataloged, so that the data is clean. Once that data is collected, we process it using Apache Beam for different use cases. All this data is stored in different cache as well as data structure to serve these use cases. We have a query engine and support different BI tools like Tableau, ClickView, so that people can create reports out of it. And on the right-hand side, you can see different consumers and use cases we support, including in security, in observability, cost optimization, etc. These are some of the applications that are currently using our operational data lake platform and providing actionable insight. First, we have a security use case. We collect the data for related to security, including lineage, what piece of software is running, right from the time we build a container until the end of the lifecycle when it's running in production. We can figure out what CVE affects which piece of code, not in just in build time, but at runtime, and do a triaging for that. Next is the cost reporting and analysis. This helps us with different controllers which we have written. It helps us attribute cost for any resources, CPU, memory, to a particular service and an account owner, not just for reporting, but also optimizing the cost which into expense. Another major use case we are solving is development velocity. We get data from build, get, deployment platforms to figure out what is our release velocity, and then how and provide meaningful insights into them, how we can increase the development velocity. And last but not the least is our observability application called Fuzzy, which we will go a little bit more into the next segment. The main objective of this Fuzzy is, can we reduce MTTI, MTTD for all services that are running at Intel? Now over to Vijit, who will go over our Fuzzy observability application and show us a demo.
Thank you, Amit. Now I'm going to talk about Fuzzy, our observability application built on top of ODL. Why did we build Fuzzy? We found a couple of issues in the current way of doing. That mean time to detect is too long. In most of the cases, what we found out is we would love to detect in a standardized way, because either we wanted to detect when a customer is impacted, either an internal or external. There should be a standard, almost standard way to do that. As soon as we get into an incident, the first thing the incident responder or the service owner looks for is, how can we ascertain the customer impact? Who are the customers who are impacted? What is the level of impact? And which are the endpoints they are being affected? The percentages, the numbers, and so forth. Once we know that, we would love to solve the problem. That is, isolate the source and the root cause. Source could be the source service, while the root cause could be the cause element. The root cause is a little tricky. So for those some cases where we cannot find the root cause, we would need the domain experts to come in and debug or triage the problem. When the domain experts come in, what they find out is there is a large latency in data retrieval. This is due to the exponential growth in the data. Organic growth, more systems are being added. So we wanted to have a near real-time interactive system where they could explore the data and triage the problem. So this is why we built Fuzzy. What's the charter of Fuzzy? Fuzzy has three main objectives. One is make obvious what services are affected. Second is what is the causal service? And third, the causal event. Once we have this, we believe, and we can show that any non-expert will be able to triage the problem. By non-expert, what we mean is we don't need domain-level expert to triage. We should be able to isolate the problem very, very quickly than what is happening. We will talk about how ML is helping us in that. And once we are able to reduce the mean time to isolate, we will reduce the mean time to resolve. How are we doing it? Fuzzy is being an ODL app, uses the same four pillars of ODL. We have collection, processing, ML, and analytics. In collection, we collect all the data that is being exposed by the cloud provider. In our case, it's AWS. We have AWS CloudWatch, CloudTrail, Cloud Events, all kind. From the platform side, that is, we use Kubernetes. We get the audit logs. We get the Kubernetes objects, object changes, the events using data controller. We have a standardized way of scraping the metrics. That is via Prometheus. So any application that runs on Kubernetes, we can get the time series metrics out by scraping the Prometheus, and we send that to Kafka. Recently, we also started getting sampled OpenTelemetry metric traces. Now that we collect this all different data from different systems and applications, we do processing. Windowing is the most important processing we do, where we window the data to a fist or a session window. The reason we window is we want to make sure that the customers of this data won't have trouble putting the out-of-order events into order and so forth. So we put it into fixed granularity. Once we put it into fixed windows, we also make sure that there is asset ID so that we can correlate all these metrics and join these metrics. Kubernetes data will be very specific to Kubernetes, but we have to inject asset ID, so we have to derive that. That is one main job of processing tool. Once we have clean data, which is correlatable, we write it to multiple different stores for different speeds of retrieval, Redis, Elasticsearch, Druid, and so forth. On ML, we have unsupervised models that is trained to detect the anomalous measurements on this data. These ML models are trained per service because each service is very unique in its behavior. A quick example would be, for one application, Redis cache misses are okay, but for another, misses are not okay. So it's tuned per service to be very precise. On analytics, we use this ML score, the anomaly score, as the guiding factor for guided debugging. When I say guided debugging, what we mean is, let's say you can divide your application in four segments, your app infrastructure applications, your AWS, and your Kubernetes. If you are seeing a high anomaly in your AWS side, you really don't have to debug the application side because it's clear that the problem is happening on AWS side. This way, user can narrow down to the problem very fast, and the guiding factor is the anomaly score which we generate. Our analytics platform also builds hierarchical view, so we could see the view from the Intuit level, the BU level, the Scrum level, so we can see the impact radius. The data is very rich, and we would love to share this data with everybody at Intuit, so we expose the entire data over GraphQL for consumption. The fuzzy architecture. This architecture is very similar to the ODL architecture because it's built on top of ODL. I highlighted using green to show what are the components in ODL used to buy fuzzy. We have IKS controllers that pulls in all the data. API GW is API gateway. Any two services that talk to each other always talk through API gateway. We use black box inference to gather data about how the interaction, who are talking to each other, what status codes they are emitting, what endpoints do they talk to, what is the latency, and so forth. There is a plethora of information there. We use Argo CD and Argo rollouts, and these generate data to help us understand when did the deployment start, if things have gone out of sync, how fast is the rollouts progressing, and so forth. This helps us give a lot of insights on the deployment. Dev portal is where we create service. That's the starting point for a developer. It has our golden entity, that is our asset ID. So we get data and we use that asset ID for enriching. Autel is our open telemetry collector. This is very new. All the data is being written to Kafka. We do curation, cleanup, and store to the deep store for big data analysis over a longer period of window. Every data is cataloged. Here on the processing side, you see SPP, tumbling processors. SPP is doing the most of the heavy lifting, which is doing the windowing, cleaning, joining, and so forth. Tumbling processors are very efficient codes with the aim to write to Redis in different data structures, and it is optimized for that. This main point of tumbling processor is for the fuzzy UI to be able to slice and dice the data as the user requires. So we write it in different formats so that we can users can slice and dice. I will talk more about ML in the coming slide. Then we, of course, have a GraphQL that exposes the entire data. We use cache, different kind of cache stores based on the requirement and the ML architecture. So this architecture is built on Kubernetes because we wanted a scalable system that could run thousands of models. It uses Argo workflows, Argo CD, and Argo events to make it scalable and resilient. What we do is in the dispatcher, it gets pre-aggregated clean data. It looks into the messages, see which service does this message belong to, and forward to the stream detector. Stream detector has a model per service. So two things could actually happen. When a message comes in the stream detector, it will see that, hey, I already have a model for this in cache, assign the anomaly score. Other thing is it does not have a model. So it looks in the model store, gets the latest model, and assign a score. Some days you might not even find a model in a model store because it's a newly onboarded application. We do create dynamic models. That's the key thing. So it asks the on-demand training system to train a model, and the model trainer will write a model back to the newly trained model back to that model storage so that the service can be assigned a score in the later messages when the new messages come. The publish adapter publishes to multiple endpoints. Today, we read from Kafka and we publish to Kafka. That is the default. So we write the anomaly score back to Kafka topic so others can consume it and they can set up, use the data as they see fit. We also do GitOps because we want to make sure that users can add new models without redeploying the entire thing. So if somebody adds a new NLP-based model, they just need to write it in GitOps saying that, hey, this is a new model for the service. Once it is merged, a new model will be available, auto-trained and be available for the metrics to be assigned score with. Demo. Now, let's get into details of Fuzzy through a demo. This is the incident commander view of Fuzzy on the first page. The whole point of Fuzzy is it does not require any onboarding. Any user at Intuit, any service at Intuit, the moment they are onboarded, moment they are created, will get Fuzzy for free. The front page of Fuzzy, what it shows is the top 10 services at Intuit that is behaving most anomalously out of thousands of services we have. The way to interpret this is the score of 0 means all is good, while the score of 10 means it is most anomalous. From this, user could understand that there are some anomalous services at Intuit, and they would like to go more to understand what is the causal service and the causal event that could have triggered this. For this purpose, they go to the detailed view of Fuzzy. The most important information they look for and as a service owner is the radius impact. That's what they care about the most, to understand who is being impacted because my application is behaving bad. For that, we have an application dependency graph. Let's say I am the owner of application classic, right? My service has a score of 10. That means there is an issue. It clearly shows that who are the clients that are affected because of the anomalous behavior in my application and what is the score. All of them are being impacted because of it. We also show a service to service anomaly over a score over the edge on how the call used to be and how the call is. And we highlight that score. The 10 means it's a total impact. I could also see that, hey, I depend on entitlement, and entitlement seems to be an issue. That could be the causal service that is triggering this incident. As an owner of entitlement, what I would want to know is, hey, what is the causal event? So let's assume this is the detailed view which can be used to understand what's going on, right? So the way to interpret this set of graphs or set of charts are, we show it as a segment as each hop. So there are three major hopes we show as of today. One is the hop number one is the API gateway. Any two services at Intuit talks to interacts with each other via API gateway. So it's clear that, hey, there are some issues. You see a spike in errors, both of 502 and 504s. And you could see the error rate. It has around 8% error rate we are seeing. This data could be, so we summarize this data and we show them on a heat map so that they could know what's happening. We could even actually, if you see in here, we could actually slice, do a quick summarization by clicking over a span and see over a time of 5 minutes, 15 minutes, what's the error distribution. Now that I see that, hey, there is a lot of errors, I would like to know what's happening. Clearly, I can see that, hey, the load balancer, which is serving the sitting in front of the service, is also showing a spike in errors. User could clearly click into it and see whether it's a target metric and a load balancer, whether it's being generated by the load balancer, is clearly shown by the load balancer. Now we would like to know what is triggering it. That is where we look into in the Kubernetes namespace to see, hey, how are the events looking at the namespace level? And we see that, hey, there is something at the deployment side, something is happening. Once you click on it, it shows that, hey, somebody at Intuit has run a restart on the deployment, which is causing the issue. This clearly shows a non-expert, to be frank, to see, hey, I see an error, I see a deployment, and what is causing the deployment. These are all interactive. You could click on to see, hey, what's happening, right? I have 26 events in pod. You could click on it and you can see what's the sequence of events that happened and how is it working. Since there are a lot of data, we also summarize it as an exclamation point so that this exclamation is all about bubbling up the most causal reason which you might be interested in, which could be triggering the incident. For example, if you click here, like it shows that, hey, the network is failing because the ports are unhealthy. Ideally, there should be only one exclamation point and which shows the real event, and we are trying to improve our machine learning to do that, to show the causal event rather than showing a set of exclamations. We also show a quick insight onto the pod metrics and how many pods are running, so forth, and what is the CPU usage for a while, just to sort for the user to see what's happening. They could search for their pod. They can see, okay, I am running 5 pods, and this is how the memory distribution is. These are also color coded between 0 to 100. So from here, I hope I was able to convince you that, hey, from an error API gate, an error in the system or an incident, we are able to find the root cause very fast. Now I will hand it over to Amit for the closing statements.
Thank you, Vijit. As you can see in the demo, we have done very good progress on operational data lake and using that operational data to solve some of the use cases. So what's coming next? We want to make sure that we support custom metrics. It's bring your own metrics. We are expanding our self-service capabilities for open-ended debugging, also expanding our ML for more on-demand models, and we are planning to do open source. Next slide. Thank you for attending our talk.